Back home, the Communications Minister, Richard Alston, has called on the ABC to hold an inquiry into its coverage of the Iraq war. Senator Alston's call followed his criticism yesterday of the ABC Radio Current Affairs program, AM, in which he claimed was biased against the US military.
I think the ABC has a duty to its listeners and the taxpaying public to uphold the highest standards of journalism, to accept that it's accountable, and to ensure that it is meeting its own codes of practice.
Senator, we couldn't agree more. Welcome to Media Watch. I'm David Marr. We can't say goodbye to 2003 without taking a backward glance at the biggest media story of the year, the Senator's 68 complaints of bias against the ABC. Two inquiries have thrown most of them out, but the story may not be over yet. Senator Alston has told Media Watch,
I am currently considering my further options in this matter.
From the start, there was something fishy about Senator Alston's claim to be speaking on behalf of a large constituency of concerned Australians. When he delivered his dossier of complaints to the ABC's general manager, he wrote,
Dear Mr. Balding, during the Iraq conflict, my office has received a number of complaints of biased and in particular anti-American coverage by the ABC, particularly the AM program.
But what number? Here he was on the Insiders a couple of days later, deliberately giving the same impression of riding a groundswell.
Let's look at some of the complaints you made against the AM program in particular. A lot of work went into this.
Well, Barry, we did get a number of complaints from the public during the course of the war, and I didn't think it was appropriate to be saying anything until after it was over. We went through those pretty carefully. It seemed to me that the critical thing for the presenter is to make comments or analysis that are justified by the evidence.
Exactly. But on the evidence of complaints reaching the ABC, there was little concern in the community about ABC bias. And what there was split 50-50.
Audience contacts.
A key concern in the audience contacts this year was ABC coverage of the Iraq war, with more than 7,000 audience contacts received. There were 144 complaints related to anti-US coverage and 147 complaints about pro-US coverage.
But where were the battalions complaining to the Minister for Communications? Media Watch made formal requests under the Freedom of Information Act to both the Minister's office and his department, asking for
all such complaints and all logs and records of such complaints.
We expected a mountain of paper, but all the Minister's office and his department could rake up between them were 9 complaints. 9 written complaints from the general public of anti-American bias in ABC reporting in the 2 months between the start of the war and the Minister flagging his attack. None of those 9 letters even mentioned AM. They were certainly angry.
Dear Mr. Alston, I'd like to register my disgust with the ABC's handling of the Iraq war. They have demonstrated a glee with every coalition difficulty which occurred, referred to the slaughter of civilians in the Baghdad marketplace, warned listeners of the perils of paying any attention to the hawkish Fox News, and generally behaved like a bunch of America-hating lefties.
What about phone calls? The minister's receptionist, Erica, sent him this fax as coalition forces took Baghdad.
Hi, Richard. I have received a large number of phone calls since the war began from irate constituents about mainly ABC and SBS footage showing graphic pictures of injured and dead US soldiers and bias anti-war comments from reporters.
How many calls? Which reporters? ABC, SBS or right across the board? We don't know because, unlike the ABC, the Minister's office kept no records of such calls. His then Chief of Staff, David Quilty, told Media Watch,
We didn't have a log. People would be asked if they wanted to put their concerns in writing.
And there's no paper trail that might link those calls to the Minister's attack on the ABC. Quilty told Media Watch there are no briefing notes, no drafts, no working papers.
Basically, what was produced was one document, and it was simply updated electronically in terms of drafts. That document became the final complaint.
So evidence of the groundswell amounted to this, a number of unlogged telephone calls and 9 letters. There was a 10th that actually named AM, its presenter Linda Mottram, and a morning of reports that would provoke 10 of those 68 complaints. But that letter came not from a member of the general public, but the federal director of the Liberal Party, Brian Loughnane. Here's Mottram.
It is said that military plans only last until they encounter reality, and with continued resistance across southeastern Iraq, it appears that the coalition's plans there are in disarray.
And here's Loughnane's complaint.
To describe the military coalition's plans as being in disarray is inaccurate and a significant exaggeration in this context. The coalition is facing some resistance. However, pockets of resistance do not combine to an accurate assessment of the coalition's plans being in disarray.
Reporting the fighting from southern Iraq that day, the New York Times was not so reassuring.
Nasiriya, Iraq, March 24.
As American Marines battle their way into the heart of this city today, they appeared to be stepping into just the sort of urban imbroglio they had been hoping to avoid. After heavy fighting on Sunday, when at least 10 Americans were killed near here, the battle that unfolded today had all the hallmarks of a confused and chaotic urban shootout.
Loughnane's objection to disarray perfectly captures the tone and purpose of the dossier Senator Alston presented to the ABC. It was not the public complaining, it was the party and the government. A government with a war to fight and a war to sell. It's very familiar territory.
During the first Gulf War in 1991, the then Labor Prime Minister Bob Hawke also claimed the ABC's war coverage was biased.
Mr. Hawke praised certain news reporters, but said, and I quote, "I find it difficult to summon the language to describe my contempt for their analysis by so-called experts. They are loaded, biased, and disgraceful."
12 years down the track, Canberra was again laying that charge, this time in extraordinary detail. 17 pages, 68 complaints. After investigating them for 7 weeks, the ABC's complaints review executive, Mr. Murray Green, rejected the bias charge.
The 130-page reply upheld only two of Senator Alston's complaints. Both involved reports from Washington. One, relating to US President Bush's sensitivity to the bombing campaign, was classed as speculative reporting. The other was described as sarcastic in tone and excessive.
Within hours of the verdict, Senator Alston was fighting back hard.
I've only had an opportunity to look at about half a dozen of these responses to date, and when I've worked my way through them all, then I'll be in a position to make a considered judgment. But from what I've seen to date, I have to say that the ABC seems to have gone to quite extraordinary lengths to exonerate itself, and I don't know that that is justified by the evidence that it itself relies upon. Certainly in the first few I've looked at, that it's quite the opposite.
After its clash with Canberra in the first Gulf War, the ABC set up an independent panel to review its own in-house assessments of complaints. Now, with Senator Alston raging against Green's verdict, the ABC took the bizarre course of appealing against its own victory by sending the Alston dossier to this independent panel. The ABC's managing director explained,
"Notwithstanding the thorough and rigorous examination by Mr. Murray Green, a report that I continue to stand by, I believe it is in the public interest that this matter be further reviewed by a body that is independent and external to the ABC."
The panel, Ted Thomas, former general manager of Channel 7 in Sydney, Bob Johnson, another Channel 7 man, Margaret Jones, once a Sydney Morning Herald writer, law professor Michael Chesterman, and New South Wales Community Relations Commissioner Stepan Kirkasharian, would also dismiss Senator Alston's fundamental charge against AM.
The panel finds no evidence overall of biased and anti-coalition coverage, as alleged by the minister. Nor does it uphold his view that the program was characterised by one-sided and tendentious commentary by program presenters and reporters.
But they did uphold not two but 17 of the senator's complaints, helped by the ABC's suggestion that they
give consideration to seeking a further submission from Senator Alston,
who accepted this invitation and worked up a second complaint twice as long as his first. It resulted in four of the fresh findings against the AM journalists, but it has never been shown to them or the ABC. Even now, the senator's comprehensive analysis, as it's called, remains secret. When Media Watch asked to see it, Senator Alston refused and made veiled threats.
"It was not intended to be a public document. Moreover, as I am currently considering my further options in this matter, it would not only be improper, but potentially prejudicial for the document to be made public by you or anyone else. I therefore formally request you to act accordingly.
Media Watch asked the ABC's Russell Balding if he thought it was appropriate for the panel to be considering fresh grounds of complaint from Senator Alston. It seems not.
The ABC has not been privy to Senator Alston's further submission to this independent review panel. However, in principle, the ABC believes that all complaints should be referred to the ABC in the first instance.
We asked panel convener Ted Thomas,
why was no material sought from the journalists? Why was an invitation to provide a comprehensive analysis of Mr. Green's findings extended to Senator Alston, but not to the journalists? Why were the journalists not given a chance to comment on the minister's analysis?
Mr. Thomas replied that the panel was primarily reviewing the Green report, and as the journalists had been extensively consulted by Mr. Green,
there was no automatic need to speak directly with program personnel or to seek further representations from the ABC.
Not good enough. The panel made 15 new findings against journalists who had no right of reply to complaints they were never allowed to see. The panel was supposed to give reasons for every finding. It didn't. It was supposed to make findings only about serious bias. It didn't. Independent isn't enough. The panel has also got to be transparent and fair. Our detailed analysis of the panel's findings and all our correspondence can be found on our website at abc.net.au/mediawatch. Now to some harsh adjudication of our own, picking the winner of the Mighty Barra. 2003 has seen contenders great and small, from Mr. Motivator to Mr. Bitch and even Mr. Prime Minister. It's never an easy choice, but two entries stood out. Not for originality, of course, but for brazenness. Piers Ackerman was the very first contender of the year. Piers wasn't only quoting Al Hilali. Everything he said about him and his views was taken from an Israel Defence Force press release.
Abu Ayman al-Hilali, a senior member of the al-Qaeda terror organisation, marked the US, Britain, France, Italy, Canada, Germany and Australia as enemies of the organisation.
A few weeks earlier, this august commentator from a major newspaper had mined a website for another slab of 350 words. That's brazen enough, but what about Piers trying to get out of it by redefining the offence?
I don't consider repeating quotes or reporting news which has appeared elsewhere to be plagiarism. Neither act involves the theft of original ideas.
Piers would have taken home the fish in any but a year as remarkable as 2003, when he was again denied the catch, this time by his own editor-in-chief, Campbell Reid, who published this astonishing theft in the telly.
50 things to do before you die.
Swim with dolphins.
Scuba dive on Great Barrier Reef.
Trek in the Tasmanian wilderness.
Go whale watching.
The story was pinched from a BBC television program and website.
50 things to do before you die.
1. Swim with dolphins.
2. Dive the Great Barrier Reef.
3. Fly on Concorde.
4. Whale watching.
The judges were impressed not only by the brazenness of the plagiarism, the telly lifted the lot with just a few little changes to fit the local scene, but also by Campbell Reid's resolute silence once again in the face of exposure. Campbell Reid is a true original, an editor-in-chief who doesn't seem to give a damn when his paper is caught filching other people's work. That's why the Barra bears his name, and that's why Campbell Reid is the worthy winner for 2003. Until next year, good night.